Hello everyone, welcome to the first episode of Let's Go Candid with Ooja, an interview podcast series by Ooja, the Commerce Department, Sri Guru Gobind Singh College of Commerce, where we invite people from different backgrounds, people who chose unconventional paths in their lives, people who've been through hardships and struggles but never thought to give up and are known by the world out there. On our first episode of Let's Go Candid with Ooja, we have someone who started working at a very early age. Someone whose life has been like a roller coaster. He's someone who makes people laugh. After all, laughter is the best therapy. He's an entertainer, a stand-up comedian by profession, laughterpreneur. He's none other than the man himself, Mr. Jiveshu Ahluwalia. Welcome, sir.
Thank you so much, Mac. Thank you for having me over. How can I help? Please tell me.
The interview has two segments. Each segment has a certain set of questions which are designed by the team itself.
Okay.
These are the questions related to your personal and your professional life. And as the name suggests, let's go candid with Ooja. We hope to have honest and candid answers from you.
I hope you can handle them. Sure, go ahead. Shoot.
All right. Thank you, sir. So my first question for you. How was your experience of having an online comedy show and how was it different from a real stand-up?
Live audience has a touch and feel to it. You can feel the laughter from them. You can feel the energy from them. So when we were going to virtual scenarios, I was very scared. I had no idea what will happen. And then I've done about 40 of those now. And I think first few were the learning curve. We couldn't figure out. At least I couldn't figure out, or my team couldn't figure out the internet, and then the pace of the joke, because stand-up is a very audio-visual art form. So if you're on your cell phone with your eyes stuck on your screen and you're not looking at the comic, you'll miss the joke. And then the pace of the internet has to be a little slower than the live audience. You have to talk a little slowly. You have to make sure your gestures are just above body, upper torso sort of a thing, because that is the view you get, like this big. So you can't do a lot of enactment with your chest down areas. So a lot of dynamic approach probably, but it has been awesome. I think I could not have asked for a better deal to have. And I'm too lazy because for every show, what I have to do is I have to get out of my bedroom, go to my study or my office and set up my light and laptop and a mic stand, if you see right there. I do stand up when I actually stand up and do it, so that I have a mic stand and a mic so I get a feel of the energy that I get. Also, I don't want to feel lazy while I'm sitting and talking like to you right now, because this is a relaxed way. But when people pay for it, I wanted them to get the most of the money part. You know, when somebody pays 250 rupees, 300, 500 rupees, I don't want them to say, "Arey yaar, paisa diya, isse acha to hum Suryavansham dekh lete." Sony Maxper, you know? Yeah, Seth Maxper. I don't want them to say that. So it was a lot of challenge, but then it is going great. I mean, every show, you realize that the audience is the one who is more dynamic in accepting you. It is not the artist. It is the audience which takes the ownership. So I'm thankful from my bottom of my heart to them, so that they accepted the part of virtual shows happening.
That was very well answered, sir. So my next question to you, from being telecasted on national television through shows like Comedy Circus and Laughter Challenge, comedy has now shifted to YouTube, especially among youngsters. So how has this change over the years has been to you, and what do you think the future of comedy will be like, in especially a country like India?
So what we have to realize is that stand-up is still a very old art form, and it's a US originated art form. In India, we used to have maskarades and bhand and nautanki and natak back in the day. Laughter Challenge and Comedy Circus are the people recognized for what we do. They had no idea till about 10 years ago what we were doing. And I wasn't there 10 years ago, but there were a few comics who were there 10 years ago, like Papa CJ, or, you know, there were people who were not able to relate as to what they do. For them, comedy was Sunil Pal, Raju Srivastava, Naveen Prabhakar, Kapil Sharma, Krishna Sudesh, Johnny Lever, and then as and when Bollywood was happening. Has it worked for us? Yes, they have put us on the map. I mean, there is no doubt about it that I owe everything that I have right now for the TV to happen and making us realize that what we're doing. What YouTube does is that it takes off the censorship. So because when you do it on TV, TV has a term called GEC, which is called General Entertainment Category. You cannot do a lot of stuff which relates to religion, caste, creed, sex, and political orientation, which YouTube does not bar. So it gives a lot of alternative for people who want to actually foray into those kind of genres and want to do comedy about it, want to create humor about it. So it is a great platform for them. However, as I said, my mother watches Comedy Nights with Kapil. I watch Comedy Nights with Kapil. I'm sure your parents don't watch YouTube as much as they watch TV. And I think that's pretty much it. So I think what will happen at the future for comedy, I think it will grow. Because since it is a US art form, it is about 80 years old in US, wherein you can actually crack a joke of your mama is so fat and your mama is so black and your mama is so white and your mama is so... Out here, we cannot crack those jokes because our audience is also about 8, 9, 10 years old. Our mothers are still very pious to us. So whenever I crack a joke, I try to crack a joke which is not related to caste, creed, religion, sex or politics because I don't want to offend anyone. But that doesn't make me right and it doesn't make anybody else wrong who is doing it. The future will be, I think, at the end of the day, the future will always be your phones and your tablets and your TV, which will have your fingertip entertainment, which is like Netflix or Amazon or Hotstar, wherein people may not watch TV as much because TV is controlled. Out there, they can pick and choose what they want. So that will happen. And it is happening.
Since you just mentioned about OTT platforms,
yeah,
we've seen this industry growing rapidly over the years, and there have been a lot of entertainers and comedians who've had their specials being streamed on platforms like Amazon Prime and Netflix. Can we also expect to have a fun-filled exclusive from your end too?
It's not just
a question, but it's more like a request from your fans out there.
I hope so. Amazon could have happened a couple of years ago. I wasn't ready for it. We had some discussions, but then not with Amazon, but the mediator, the liaisoning people. So I don't know if Amazon is even aware of if they were talking to me, but I did not want to put trash out. And I wasn't very confident with my jokes, you know. There are a lot of specials, you're right. There are a lot of specials on Netflix. There are a lot of specials on Amazon. But when you see a comic who is seasoned, there are people who are on Netflix, which is like Dave Chappelle or Bill Burr or Louis C.K. These guys have been doing for 30, 40 years. Gabriel Iglesias, you know. I don't think so. Our comics are even worthy of having a special. I honestly don't think. I think they're all absolutely learning right now.
I can actually suggest you a really good title for your
Yes, please. Yes, please.
We were actually, contemplating about having a title for this episode.
Correct.
So we came up with a title as the one with Mr. Jiveshu Ahluwalia.
I've heard this too many times, Max. The issue is that I'm so lazy with my naming of the specials. My last special was Main Aa Raha Hoon. It is the laziest special to even name. Main Aa Raha Hoon is like, it is the stupidest thing to even mention it. Second one was Jiveshu Live. I did not even bother to name it. First one was, I paid some attention. I actually named it Jiveshu Unabashed, Uninhibited, and Unapologetic. It was so complicated that I didn't even say it myself. Then people say, what is it? What did you make? I'm like, that's it. But yeah. I think Alu Walia to Alu Vadia can be a nice special name.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
So, my next question.
Yeah.
We know everybody's life is full of ups and downs, and your life has also been full of struggles. You started working at a very early age, mm-hmm. from being a delivery boy to working at a call center and making it big in the corporate world out there.
Yeah.
You have faced quite a lot of challenges in your life. And that is what the pandemic has done to most of us. The pandemic has pushed most of the youngsters into a corner. And it's getting really difficult to come out of it and to, begin a new journey. So what advice would you give to the youngsters out there?
I think they need to get a grip on their life. This is not a challenge. If you have a roof over your head, if you have a food in your belly, and if you have a bed to sleep on, you're a moron to cry about anything else. There are people who are dying out there. There are people who have lost their livelihood. There are people who are selling their businesses. There are people who have lost everything they ever worked for in their life. If you have, like you have a nice clothing to wear, you have food to eat, you have a roof over your head. If you come and tell me there is something wrong in your life, I'm going to slap you. Because it's simple. You don't know what issues are. You don't know what problems are there. A lot of youngsters, the problem is that they're so socially connected to people on social media and so absolutely disconnected with the real life issues in life that they don't know what the real world is. It is very easy to sit in an air-conditioned room and talk about all of these things. You know, like you have Zoom right now. I mean, I can guarantee 50% of India doesn't even have internet. If you come and cry about that you have problems in life, then please go get a reality check. And that's the issue. That is where it ends. So I don't think so. I need to give any answers to youngsters. Youngsters need to get a grip on their life and start realizing that this is the best that will ever be. Hamare yahan youngsters gadhe hain aajkal. They are absolute jackasses. So there's no advice for them. Our advice is to get their bloody head out of wherever they've shoved it and get a reality check and get a grip on life. They have no right to complain. Nothing that they should complain about.
Exactly. It's your determination and will that makes you who you are.
Everywhere. Every time your father did not sleep or your mother did not sleep because Mehak was sick, and every time your father did not buy that piece of watch that he wanted or a camera because he had to pay your fees, that is where dedication and properly sacrificed things are. What have you done?
Nothing so far.
Exactly my point. So give yourself some chance. Whatever opportunities you have, you're studying right now, study to be the most amazingly student or a successful student you will be. So that you have a whatever you want to pursue, creative, arts, passion, whatever you want to do. Do it with the whole heart. That's the only advice. If you want to cry, then cry with your heart. If you want to cry, then cry with your heart. You should cry with your Devdas. Otherwise, you have no right to cry also.
Definitely, I agree with you on this. Okay, so let's move on to the next question. It's actually quite a big question, so I'll be asking you in parts, in different pieces basically.
Okay.
So the first question, what is the process and how do you add craft to a real life situation to present it as a solid stand-up?
So there are two types of comics. One who write fiction. And I think people who write fiction are very talented. And they are people who are storytellers or they do anecdotal comedy, which is like what I do. So I have to observe, witness, or experience something for me to write a joke about it. I think people who write fiction are extremely talented. I have no talent in those terms. And I think I'm an absolutely talentless comic because I don't have a joke. I go up on stage and I talk about my stories. I talk about my life. That is a sad. I mean, I don't even... People who write jokes like though... Those are creative people. I'm useless. So what happens as a process is that you either are very creative in imagining something which is extremely funny, especially for a standards standpoint, that you create an image, you create a world. For example, if I'm on stage, I'll bring Mehak into that world, create that bubble, and then burst that bubble into a funny way. That is fiction. If similarly, when I have to do my life story, which is an observation, anecdotal, or a storytelling, which has been experienced, witnessed, or observed, I have to build you in my story somewhere. I have to take you on a journey with me. So whenever I talk about ki hamari maa aise sab kuch banati hai jo kharab banta hai, I have to do it in a way that you connect your mother at that point. You connect one sabzi that you hate. You connect that. You may not hate aloo vadiya, but you may hate ghiya, torai, tinde, karela, whatever, right? Bangan. So that's how you do it. So I do the latter one. I am not creative as the fictional part. I wish I was, but I'm absolutely useless with talent. Just terrible.
Next question. How do you find that this is a funny joke and this is going to work on this audience? And what happens when you don't get the desired response out of them?
So you don't know where the joke will work. If I could figure out that formula, then I'll be, it's like saying somebody that how do you not make hit movies all the time? There's no formula to it. India makes about 950 Bollywood movies a year. 5 of them you get to see. 10 of them are hit. That's it. योर वर्क रेशियो इज लाइक सेइंग कि मेरे कितनी औलाद होगी उसमें से कितने सारे सीईओ बनेंगे. यू डोंट नो. यू होप एंड प्रे दैट द जोक विल वर्क. आई एम श्योर योर पेरेंट्स होप महक विल स्टडी वेल एंड डू वेल इन लाइफ, बट द इक्वल प्रोबेबिलिटी इज दैट यू मे नॉट. सो आई डोंट नो इफ द जोक विल वर्क. And when you go up on stage and the joke doesn't work, you want to kill yourself. You want to come back home and you question, are you fit to be a comic? Are you okay? What did you do when you left your job? What is this? Is it even worth it? A bad show can make you feel really shitty in your life. But that also makes you learn a lot. So yeah, a bad show can make you feel absolutely remorseful for every decision you have taken.
So what do you do in that situation? Do you
come home and cry? You come home to your hotel room and cry. You come home, you talk to your girlfriend, you talk to your boyfriend, you talk to your parents, whoever you're close to, and say, "Yaar, mera show itna kharab hua," and that's it. And then you go back home and you start working on it again. You realize what. See, at the end of the day, what happens is when you do a bad show, you realize when it is going bad. That is the beauty of being in a live audience. You don't have a second take. You don't have a second chance. So when things are going shitty, you know it is going to go. It is going to go bad. So in your subconscious mind, it is registering as to what is going wrong. So you don't go back again and do that same mistake again. You learn.
Basically, there's no formula to judge your audience.
No. There is no. An audience is never wrong. Anybody who pays for your show, anybody who pays for your art form to come and see as an audience, they have every right to expect everything that you have to offer. If you don't deliver, there are comics who will say the audience was bad. I think you're a moron comic. You're a stupid comic to say that. Audience is never wrong.
Oh, it's just that your aura is pretty much defined, and that is what makes people connect with you so easily.
Oh, yeah, yeah. With you. But then also, man, what happens is there are times when you do it in other countries. Like I remember when I was doing a show in Taipei. I've done shows in Milan, which is Italy, Spain, Norway, Sweden. Those are not the countries which relate to our scenarios. You have to research. You have to research about the audience. You have to research about... I still remember I was doing a show in New Zealand and I was doing a tour in Australia. And I used to research about local things in Australia. Like, for example, in Australia, you cannot have a jet spray in a washroom. You can't. It's illegal. You know, things like that. So I started cracking jokes about how toilet paper would work. Because that is what they could relate. Now, toilet paper joke will not work in India because nobody in India uses toilet paper. Or to that extent. So as a comic, you have to research, you have to find, you have to relate. Will it work? Maybe. Will it not work? Absolutely. Yeah, yeah.
Also, you're a Punjabi, so does it make a bit easier for you?
I think it does because Punjabis are by far very moofat and very witty. Hum ghar mein behas bahut karte hain. So I think for me, every time I do a joke, my innateness of being Punjabi comes across very, very strongly. Be it in the dialect that I have or the way I talk or I bring Delhi with me, the frustration that I have, you know. So it does make it easy for me, for sure, for sure. Also, I think the scenario of your house also helps. Like my mother is extremely funny. My brother is extremely funny. So whenever I talk to them, like for example, if I ask my mother Ratko ki ek glass pani ka de do, she says, main teri baap ki naukar nahi. You know. And I love that. I don't think every mother, I'm sure a lot of mothers say that, but I make a note of it because I think it is really funny. And I tell like, aap mere baap ki naukar nahi, lekin baap ki biwi to ho. You know, so that banter you realize. I mean, it is obviously not related to stand-up, but if you're young and you've been doing this, it builds onto your humor content.
It's good that you keep having these fun banters with your parents. With
oh
your
God, hell no. I hate her. No.
Okay.
No, obviously it is nice. Yeah, yeah. Jokes apart. Yeah, it is nice.
So, let's move on to the last question of this segment.
Sure.
We know that stand-up is a journey from the drawing room to the stage. Mm-hmm. And there are still a lot of people who criticize those who want to pursue stand-up comedy as a profession. It's mm-hmm. because people are really confused how to channelize their passion or their talent into making a career out of it. Because there's no defined path in following stand-up comedy as a profession. So correct. What baby steps should a person take, especially someone who's aspiring to become a comedian and or an entertainer?
So what I face now is I get a at least 10 messages a day, people asking me, how do I make a viral video? And I tell them, focus on the video part, let the viral be on the audience. It's like, how do I make a hit movie? You don't make a hit movie, make a movie. The content is good, it'll become a hit. So I think for you to be a stand-up comic, I think you need to figure out just two things in life. Write original material and get up on stage. Those are the only two things you need to do. As long as you can get up on stage and as long as you can keep writing original material and you keep writing original content and you keep experimenting it and you keep pushing it to the audience, you only get better. It's like cycling. It's like driving. The more you do, the better you get at it.
It's just that I have a lot of friends who have a really nice sense of humor. Correct. And they're good at cracking jokes. Correct. But they really don't know how to channelize this thing into, you know, making a whole...
So they can channelize. So there are a lot of open mics which happen. So there is some. There's a place, an event called open mic. Yeah. Open mic events, wherein you have slam poetry, you have poetry, you have stand-up, you have singing competitions. So register yourself to an open mic event, go up and try your material. What happens is that when you're funny to at least four more people, like you said, you have a lot of friends. When you go to a stranger and you crack a joke, and when you're sitting in a bar, when you're cracking this joke, your audience is not looking at you. The audience is looking at the beer or coffee that they're having, food that they're eating, conversation that they're having, and somebody that they're eating. The company matters. You're the last most priority, probably. So you have to be really funny to push yourself to the first slot. That is one. And two, you have to be absolutely naked about your life. Because when you talk about things, when I used to talk about my divorce or my age or my weight, I'm letting strangers judge me. You can't be bothered by it. So when you go up and if it doesn't work, you can't lose heart. And a lot of these young guys, they expect them to be absolutely viral sensations overnight. Doesn't work. Just doesn't work. You have to put in a lot of hard work to make this happen.
It's like there are professions like, you know, if you want to be a doctor, you got to clear NEET and certain set of exams. But there's no defined paths when it comes to stand-up comedy or anything.
Stand-up can do. So when you do open mics, you start doing two. So I think every open mic when you start with is gives you 3-minute slots. Then when you increase, there are open mics which give you 5-minute slots, then you have 8-minute slots, then you have 12-minute slots, then you have 18, then you have 30. So you keep progressing. And once you reach the 30-minute slot, that is when you start opening for seasoned comics. And that is how I started. I used to open shows for Amit Tandon, Zakir Khan, Maheep Singh. So a lot of these Kaniti Palta, and I used to go and open mics, and I used to open these shows for these guys. They used to give me 5, 10, 15, 20 minute slots. And the better you get, the more they give you. Because they want something to warm up the audience. You know, when you go to an audience, it is a cold audience. You go and crack some jokes, the audience is already laughing. And at the highest, you bail out and you call the main act. It's like any rock band you see, on any rock show you see, you have the local guys opening for the main act. They warm up the audience. That is how the career progression works. And that's how it works. I mean, if you keep doing it, you'll get there.
All you need to do is to keep exploring your horizons. And, you know,
write original material, get up on stage. Write more, get up on stage. Write more, get up on stage.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. Well, this marks the end of our first segment. Your answers are pretty honest and candid. So let's move on to the next segment.
So in this segment, we have some fun and frolic questions lined up for you. Okay. So we can begin whenever you're ready. All right. So who would you say is your favorite comedian nowadays and why?
No one. I hate all of them. They're all competitors. Why would I like them? It's like asking an engineer which is his favorite engineer. Nobody. Nobody's my favorite comic. Nobody. I like a lot of comics who write, like for example, Ricky Gervais wrote Afterlife on Netflix. Have you seen Afterlife? I don't know if you have seen it. Ricky Gervais is a good comic who wrote Afterlife. So I like the series that they write. I don't follow any comic or comedian, so I don't.
All right, sir. Understood. So your favorite food joint in Delhi and any specific dish that you usually go for?
Oh, yeah. Kareem's and Al-Jawahar in Jama Masjid. Oh, man. I would eat anything. The khamiri roti, the seekh kebabs, the tikke.
Chicken rolls.
Chicken stew and mutton stew. Oh my God, I want to kill myself right now. I've not been to Kareem's a million years now. The other day he messaged me, are you coming? I said, I hope so at some point.
All right. So would you rather always be 10 minutes late or 20 minutes early?
20 minutes early, any day. I hate people that are late.
Any other interest that you wanted to convert in your passion?
I wanted to be an actor. I think at some point I will take that.
So you've done quite a number of advertisements.
Yeah, I've done about 40 ads and I've done 2 movies and I've done 2 series. Yeah, yeah. But then I want to be I want to be one of those actors who get mobbed. Like right. Full Y plus security, Z type security, like Kannada Ranaut types. I want that level.
All right. So this one is a funny one. Would you rather wear a wedding dress or a tuxedo every single day or wear a bathing suit every single
day? Tuxedo every day. Oh, please. I want to look dapper. I'm that level of show off.
All right.
Only if I get tuxedo in my sizes, probably.
Okay. So, moving forward, sir, our audience is also very keen to know about the tattoos that you possess. And we would love to know the story behind them and any specific, meaning that they want to convey.
Yeah. So, I have all the tattoos which means a lot to me. So, I have a full arm which is covered. It's called a full sleeve, right? I mean, it's just covered. So, I got this Japanese fish. It's called koi. And it's considered as a fish for good luck. You don't eat it. And I got this when I was getting divorced a million years ago. And I was down and out in my life. And this fish was, one eye closed, one eye open, it was turning on the right as my luck would change. You know, that's the significance of it. I have a mic here, which signifies my stand-up, the love of stand-up. None of them I can't show you. I have my both dogs on my leg. On my right leg, because I love them. I have my mother's face on here, which is, I don't know if you can see it. It's a pretty kick-ass tattoo I have. I have my mother's name tattooed on my chest. Very bad thing to do. You should not get drunk and get tattoos. I have a lot of tattoos. I have a lot of tattoos on my back. I follow Jabji Sahab, so it is Nirbhav and Nirvair, which means without fear and without hatred. I keep getting it. I keep getting a lot of stuff on me. I'm going to get another tattoo in about a week's time. So my left arm, I'll get a sleeve done.
All right. So would you like to tell us what your plan is?
Yeah, I'm getting a Maori tattoo. I've been wanting a Maori tattoo for a while now. And Maori is a very old native tribe which does a lot of tattoos. And used to do this with nails and very traditional small hammer, like a wooden hammer. I don't have the capacity to sit through all of that. So I'm going to get a machine taken. And that signifies peace, power, love, satisfaction. So I'm going to get that.
Right, that's great to hear. Good. I mean, interesting. So you talked about your dogs and we know that you have 2 dogs, Milo and Shadow. So what do you admire about them the most?
They don't give a shit. I love that about dogs. That they just do shit. They don't give a shit. What I love about animals per se, just not about my dogs, is the unconditional love that they give. They don't care if you're fat, if you're thin, if you're black, if you're white, if you're rich, if you're poor, if you're intelligent or dumb, if you're educated or uneducated, if you have a good job or a bad job. They love you for who you are. I wish humans were like that, but they're not. Humans are sick. So I prefer dogs.
Yeah. I think most of us prefer animals over humans.
Yeah, I prefer animals any day. If I was to pick about people I love or animals any day. I think everyone I love will die and my animals will live through.
Right.
I will have very selective.
You also mentioned your mom. So we would like to know what was your mom's initial reaction when you started up with stand-up and how has it changed over the years?
I think my mother was very concerned because she wanted me to get married. So she said, "Ab tu khud se shaadi bhi nahi karega, naukri bhi chhod di. And mota hai, chota hai, divorced hai, to kya hi karega?" Because I was a director in a firm. And India, your job kind of carries a lot of credibility for you to get married, right? You know, like a woman has a secure life and finances are sorted and house is sorted. So that was our first concern. And second one was ki ab paise aayenge kahan se. I think over the period, she kind of got satisfied with whatever I was doing, I think. She kind of realized money was coming in. I was gaining a little bit of success. A long way to go, but I could sustain a healthy lifestyle. I could feed her, feed myself, take care of basic level of sustainability of living, you know, medicine, house, car. So then she stopped talking. Now she tells me, aur paise kahan se aa rahe hai, aur paise kyun nahi kamata. So yeah, Indian mothers, they will never be happy with it.
I think all mothers are like that.
She now tells me, dekho maine pehle hi bola tha tu kar leta, tu pata nahi itna late kyun kiya tune. You should have done it in your 20s. Mein shut up here, please. My mother though is ever longing, nagging mother.
Right. All right. So moving towards the end of our interview. So what are the three quick advices that you would like to give out to people who are, you know, wanting to switch their careers and who want to give it a shot?
Don't quit your studies for it. Please study because you always need to have a backup. Secondly, be very clear as to why do you want to do it. You should do it for the love of it and no other reason should be there. And that passion can be anything. That passion can be being a pilot, being a doctor, being a CA. It's just not creative arts. Just do it for the love of it, because when things go south, when things go really, really bad, the love you have for that art form or whatever you're doing in life, the passion that you have will sail you through. If you don't love what you do, you're going to regret every day of it. And third is love yourself. If you can't, then just everything is stupid enough. I mean, it's just not even worth it.
Right. I think great advice.
Yeah. Advice is easy to give. No, follow nahi karni hoti.
Right. It's okay. This marks the end of our interview. Thank you so much for joining us on our first episode of Let's Go Candid with Urja. It was such a pleasure having you with us today and being so candid with your answers. We hope that it was an informative and fun session for all of you, and I hope that you enjoyed this episode as much as we did. See you soon on the next episode of Let's Go Candid with Urja.